Sunlight provides the energy that green plants use to create sugars in the form of starches. Starches release energy into living things that digest them. This process of photosynthesis provides virtually all the energy used by living things. Light is everywhere in our daily life, whether it's optics, wave, particle, nature applications, fiber optics, televisions, mobile phones, eye, theater, architecture, culture, horticulture, ultraviolet, X-ray. And I'm sure you can think of so many more to fill many more slides. So today, really, friends, we cannot imagine life without light. So for a minute, let's delve on the question, what is light? Now, the light that we see, we are able to see with our eyes, is basically the visible light. And we know that light is an electromagnetic radiation. And the portion of that spectrum, which is visible to us, is the visible light zone. And that extends from a wavelength of 400 to 700 nanometers. So the light and all electromagnetic radiation is basically classified into radio waves. This is in the order of increasing frequency, radio waves, microwaves, infrared. And then we have the visible spectrum. And higher frequency is the ultraviolet and X-rays and gamma rays. Gamma rays being the highest frequency. Now I have a simple visual for you here, where we have a band on the upper side. And this is the electromagnetic spectrum. So on the right side, if you see on the top right side over here, we are having the frequency. And the frequency is increasing from right to left. And on the bottom of this, we are showing the wavelength, which is increasing from left to right. So here we have picturized the long waves, AM, FM, radio waves, microwave, IR. And it is this small little bandwidth, small as far as this picture is concerned, but otherwise huge in terms of its capabilities, in terms of its varieties, in terms of its utilities and what we can do with it. So that is the visible spectrum, which has been expanded over here, and which, as I said, extends from a wavelength of 400 to 700 nanometers. And beyond that, we have the ultraviolet, which obviously we cannot see. And then we have the X-rays and gamma rays. So what are the key properties of light? The key properties of light, which is a subset of the electromagnetic radiation, are basically its intensity, direction of propagation, its frequency or wavelength, and its polarization. And we also know that the speed of light, which is nearly 300 million meters per second, is one of the fundamental constants of nature. And it's the speed of light in vacuum. Light or any electromagnetic radiation would have this speed. So in physics, the term light sometimes refers to electromagnetic radiation of any wavelength, whether it's visible or not. In this sense, gamma rays, X-rays, microwaves, and radio waves are also light.
Hello.
Okay. Yeah. So I've in this slide, I am talking about the wave particle duality of light. So as in the beginning, when the understanding about light was being built up, it was understood that light is composed of waves, because that's the way we usually think and visualize about it. The thing is that the light is definitely has properties of waves, but in certain situations. Am I audible? Is it okay?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Okay.
It is okay.
Yes, sir. You are audible.
I saw a message that somebody couldn't hear. So, but however, light is not as simple as that. In fact, later on, when more research was done, including the excellent work by people like Einstein himself, we found that light is not just waves. And there are situations in which light behaves like particles. And these packets of particles, which relate to actually the absorption of light, was given the name of photon. And photon actually behaves as a particle. So in that sense, there have been ample experiments to show that light can behave as waves as well as particles by the name of photon. And that's a very complex concept to understand. I have shown a picture at the bottom, which is a very famous experiment, which I'm sure most of you would have heard and watched and discussed and talked about. And some of you might even be engaged in research connected with this. This is a double slit experiment in which there is a source, light source right here. And there are two slits in a metal sheet placed over here. Light is passing from the source through the two slits onto the screen. The point is that if light was purely a particle, then we would find that, okay, light would travel through this one hole here, one slit here and one slit here. And we would get actually two patches of light, say one over here and one over here. But in reality, if this experiment is conducted, and you can conduct it easily in the lab, or you can even conduct it by sunlight, by making a very simple equipment, and you will find that there will be an interference pattern, which is typical of the interference of waves. This is similar to, you know, a pond in which you drop, let's say, two objects at the same time, and there would be ripples emanating at those two points. And when they meet, there will be the addition and subtraction of those crests and troughs in this region. And at the end of it, surprisingly, instead of a peak over here and a peak over here, you find that the highest illumination will be in the center, which is really actually opposite the dark zone of the metal sheet. So this typically illustrates the double slit experiment used to show that light is indeed composed of waves. But then further experimentation, as I mentioned, if you see the energy absorption, and it is in fact the particle principle in which you have the applications like an X-ray machine, where, you know, the particle does not display this behavior. It displays a purely particle photon behavior. And that is the strange part of this experiment, because it also happens that when you actually carry out the observation, the probability or the particle nature comes out. And till you observe that particle, actually, whether it's falling at point A or point B, you don't know what is the outcome of this. And this is the field of application where so much research is going on. And still, well, mathematically, it all fits in very fine, just like the quantum theory and the theory of relativity. But if you try to understand this strange nature, it has led to a lot of discoveries, research, and a lot of applications, and still a lot is going on. So it is the very fertile area. And it's really that, you know, light is challenging us to learn more, to get more light, to understand, you know, what is really happening in nature. So, and when we talk about the packet of light, the photon, the wave function collapses, so to say. That is what is also a very interesting phenomenon. So this is what this whole picture is, and these ideas is what we refer to as the wave-particle duality. So it has both wave and particle characteristics, depending on the observation and the application. Next, I want to talk about the refraction and optics. As we've all heard, then
would you like to chat with an Alexa Prize social bot?
Alexa, stop. So we all know that you know, this is the refraction is what really causes the light to bend. When it goes into a different medium, a medium of different density, so where N1 and N2 are the different refraction indices, and light bends. So this is the concept which has huge, huge applications for magnifying glasses, spectacles, contact lenses, microscopes, telescopes, and it's a part of our daily life, and it's one of the most important properties of light. Then if we talk of the human perception of visible light, basically, if you look at this, we have the cornea over here. The cornea will not allow ultraviolet light to pass through. It gets absorbed over here. And what really gets through into the eye is the visible light, which is actually from 400 to 800 nanometers. And the rods and cones located in the retina of the human eye also cannot detect ultraviolet wavelengths. At lower end, which is the infrared, this is also invisible to humans because its photons do not have enough energy to cause a lasting molecular change in the visual molecule inside the human retina. So, and you know, the energy carried by the light is actually increases as the frequency increases. So at lower frequencies, this cannot carry out the chemical reaction and which gives a signal to the optic nerve. So this is a picture of the human eye. And these are the colors: red, orange, yellow, green, blue, and violet. And then for a minute, I want to talk about the spontaneous and stimulated emission. So emissions can be spontaneous, as in a LED, a gas discharge tube, neon lamps, etc., or even flames. However, when it is stimulated, then we have a very strong and pointed and directional beam, as in a laser or a maser. And as we just mentioned, Anupma mentioned that the laser was invented in 1960, and today we are celebrating also the start of the application of lasers. So forms of visible radiation: deacceleration of a free charge particle such as an electron can produce visible radiation. Now these examples are basically the cyclotron radiation. Even an LED would come here, because when an electron changes its band, we have a release of light. And then we have biochemicals, we have chemoluminescence, we have bioluminescence, like in a firefly, we have fluorescence, we have phosphorescence. These are the different mechanisms. And the last one is what goes into a fluorescent tube of a TV set or computer monitor. Other light producing mechanisms are listed here. Just for completion, we have these charged particles going through an electric medium. We have electroluminescence by an application of a voltage, a high voltage, scintillation, UV from phosphor when struck by high energy photon, sonoluminescence, which actually relates to sound in an ultrasonic simulation, stimulation, you know, the bubble collapses and cavitation takes place and light is emitted. And then we have physically, mechanically, if it is pulled apart, ripped, scratched, crushed, or rubbed, certain materials emit light, and that is this category of tribo. And when the concept of light is extended to include very high energy photons like gamma rays, additional generation mechanisms include particle, antiparticle, annihilation, and radioactive decay. So let's for a minute discuss about what's so special about white light. You know, we have the whole spectrum, then we have the visible light, and inside the visible light, we have a portion which is white light. Now we have to remember that color is not a property of the photon or the light. It is how our eyes perceive photons of different energies. As far as the radiation is concerned or light is concerned, it's just got a different frequency. It's not about the color. The translation into color actually comes when our eyes perceive those photons of different energies, of different frequencies, right? So white light, you see, if you talk about red light, green light or blue light, these are what we call pure light. You know, they are like a single frequency or almost a single frequency, or let's say peaking at a single frequency. So these are more or less single pure color lights. In fact, that's the reason, you know, white is got a combination of so many colors, and in particularly the three primary colors, red, green, and blue. And when they are mixed in a particular ratio, you get a white color. And when they are mixed in different proportions, you could get different shades of white color. So white by itself, you know, is a huge, huge field of lighting and of light emitting diodes. And it's extremely important. So as far as our eye is concerned, we have, again, basically, we have the three, you know, types of cones. That's again red, green, and blue. So they would then have detect that proportion of light and tell our brains, okay, this is white light, right? So now the question is that if white itself can be of so many colors, then how do we, you know, get over that? How do we quantify that? And, you know, let's say we have lights in our house or in a big hall, and they are all supposed to be white lights, and there's a slight difference. They're all white, okay, but there might be slight differences. And, you know, the human eye is so, so sensitive that a small variation, a small tinge, small difference of shade is easily perceivable when you particularly compare two or more light sources. And that can be quite displeasing if it's not intentional. I would like to mention here that, you know, the white LED came pretty, pretty late on the journey of development of LEDs, because LED has been around for very, very long time. But these were the LEDs which were like red, green, and blue. And in fact, in earlier year days when we were very young, we used to have all sorts of indicators. We used to have, you know, watches, devices, gadgets, which used to have those red and green and blue indicators. And, you know, but white LED was not there. So LED never came into the field of lighting, because lighting is where we want white light. And it was only around 2006, actually, when I myself started this journey into the LED area, when it looked very interesting. And when the what was done was that to get the red, green, and blue, basically the trick was that they used phosphor material. You know, phosphor is used in things like fluorescent lamps, the CFLs and all that. So it's really, the light is coming from the phosphor. And when the trick was done to marry the phosphor into a blue LED, the blue LED actually then got, you know, multiplied in terms of its frequency spectrum. And then it started looking like white. And that is when the whole revolution about LED lighting started taking place. Before that, it was more in indicator lamps and things like that, annunciation. So that is the time when, and after that, lots and lots of development has taken place. So let's look at the color temperature of white light, which is really the way to actually measure and quantify white light. So this term, the correlated color temperature, was actually invented as a useful way of measuring and quantifying the gradation of the whites. And basically, it's linked up to the black body radiation. The black body is basically a perfect ideal body, which can emit a perfect radiation and absorb all radiation. It is composed of a mixture of all the various possible materials, so that it doesn't reflect anything, it absorbs everything into itself. So the color temperature of light source is the temperature of an ideal black body radiator that radiates light of a color comparable to that of the light source. By this concept, like a natural daylight, if you see, it conforms to a CCT of 6500 degrees Kelvin. So what is the color space? Color space is basically a three-dimensional space, X, Y, Z, and we then project it onto a two-dimensional space for simplicity. We eliminate the amplitude part of it, and we just keep the color part into it. And that is what leads to the traditionally now used CIE diagram. And on that, in the next slide, I'll show you, we have the Planckian locus, which is actually what we talked about, the black body temperature. So I'll show you this slide, next slide. And this is what the CIE diagram actually looks like. So here, if you see, we have, you know, this is the wavelength we have given here all around it like this. And this is the Planckian locus, the Planckian curve, this black line. And this, if you see here, like if you see daylight we're talking about, that would be, this is 6,000, this is 7,000. So exactly in between somewhere, this portion would be the natural daylight on an overcast sky, would be somewhere here. Now the thing is, you might ask, okay, if it is this point, then what is all this, this and this? You know, it would actually be just a line here. Well, then we are at this point, if we go this way or this way, we are departing from the black body Planckian curve. So it we are really introducing slightly different shades over here, but at the same time, it still is a temperature, as far as the temperature is concerned, it is going by this radial line over here. So this is the way we quantify different light sources so that we are able to match these and to picturize this more clearly. You know, this is, we have shown here a piece of steel which is being heated and melted. And, you know, we know this, that, you know, when it is, the steel is cold, it is like, you know, this color. As we start heating it, it becomes red, and then it becomes white, and then it turns bluish. So if you see this lower picture here, band, 1000 degrees C would be a color like this somewhat, and say 12,000 degrees C is a bluish tinge like this. And daylight, what we talked about, would be somewhere in between over here, you know. And this is a picture where it's melted. The melting point of steel is 1300 degrees C. So I think this picture establishes and makes it quite clear to you, you know, how we quantify or what really is the shades of quantification of white light. Now here I've just put a picture of an architectural lighting. So, and there's a quote here which I really like, in the right light at the right time, everything is extraordinary. The thing is that, you know, if you see the architecture at night, I think every scene, it's inside our house, in an auditorium, in an exhibition, on the street, in the parks, on buildings, everywhere it's really light doing its magic. And in a lot of these cases, we have to use different shades of colors, of different shades of white. Like you can mix the warm white and cool white and things like that. And, you know, enhance the features of the architecture or the beauty of that structure or building. Now we come to the lighting terminology, what we use. So we have these parameters. I think most of you would be quite familiar. The luminous intensity is measured in candela. This is a directional property in which, you know, we are trying to see illuminated surface, like a source of light, a bulb or a tube light or a panel light, and it's coming to our eyes. And so it's an angular energy which is coming to our eyes. In a directional sense. So we take a solid angle, and this is the candela, is the unit. Then if we have a surface, let's say we have, let's say a 2x2 fixture. So we would say it's the candela per square meter. If you want to talk about the brightness of the surface of that particular fixture. So remember, the above two parameters are the source And if we look at the light falling on a surface, that would be the lumens. That is the photons falling on a certain area, say 1 square meter per square meter. That would be actually the lux. The lumens would be the actual energy. So per unit area would be lux. The efficacy will be lumens per watt. So what energy we are putting it and how much light lumens we are getting. LEDs have been getting more and more efficient. When they came in the beginning, they were in the tune of about 40 to 50 lumens per watt. And over the period of time now, LEDs have gone to typically 150 lumens per watt, with the result that actual fixtures we are using now are usually 100 lumens per watt. Then we have this life expectancy of the LED. That's we talk of life L70, L50 like that. So L70 really means that the lumens output of the particular LED or fixture would reduce to 70%. So we look at how much it has reduced when it has reduced to 70% in how much time. So it could be 15,000 hours, it could be 25,000 hours or 50,000 hours. Then this is a normal power and CRI, and CRI is a color rendering index. CRI is actually how pure that light is in terms of its rendering. So we say that the sunlight we talked about is an ideal. We compare with that. So compared with that, for example, an incandescent lamp will also have a near 100 CRI. But LEDs, since they are converted from different colors, in particular blue, so they would approach 100, but they may not reach 100. Now, here is what we're talking about is the light measurement equipment. The important instruments for measuring the light would be the integrating sphere. I've shown one picture of a smaller sized integrating sphere. This is the sphere, actually. It's a perfect square, and the light source is placed in the center of this, and this is the tower where we get all the measurements, power source given, and the recording done. And here, this picture is of a bigger integrating sphere used for bigger fixtures like street lights or tube lights. And as you can see, the person is also inside. It might be a 2 meters sphere. And then we have the goniophotometer, which is shown over here. And this is basically, it checks the light, which is bounced off a mirror, and it is not integrated, but it is taken piecemeal, and it is taken in all directions, and then it is summed up to get to the luminous figure, the lumens figure, or get the detail of the properties of the directional properties of the light source. And also the other parameters. Then we have the lux meter over here, which checks the lux, that is lumens per meter square at this point. And this is a spectroradiometer, which actually analyzes the spectrum of the light in terms of its different frequencies and wavelengths. And where our light source sits, it's showing here. So those instruments produce reports like these examples, which I've shown here. So this is from the integrating sphere. And you can see that our light source was here in the CIE diagram. It was a white source. And however, it was a white source, but then it was composed of these frequencies. As you can see, blue is the dominant one here. But then it's a mix of all these frequencies, which would actually come from a blue LED at the center, and then it would be converted to this spectrum by the phosphor. And in the end, we are actually seeing a white LED, so a white fixture. So here you see you've got the color temperature here. It's 6128, which is nearly quite close to the 6500 we mentioned about. Then we have the purity, we have the CRI, the color rendering index we talked about. So it's not 100, It's 84.6 here. Then the total luminous flux is shown here at 1004.35 lumens. And this is the efficiency, or rather what we call the efficacy, is 680, is 87.64, right? This is the radiant power. So, I mean, basically this is interesting that ultimately, you know, what do we really want? We want that someday when we all do more research together, we produce an LED in the future which does not waste any heat. You know, the challenge is the heat. The heat is what we waste, because we are actually looking for the light. And the heat is what makes all our applications and fixtures very difficult, because we have to dissipate it and take it away somewhere, and it troubles in attacking the phosphor and reducing the life, etc., etc. So someday, perhaps, it's on my wish list that we will have LEDs which have zero heat production, and they will be all pure light, and they'll run absolutely cool. This side, on the left side, we got the report from a Gonio photometer, which produces an IEC file, which we can use to quantify that fixture into any application. Like, you know, we have these softwares where we can take any area or room or structure or building, and then we can actually physically quantify the light sources by their IES files. And then, we can actually see what will be the effect, what will be the light pattern, what will be the uniformity, how good will it be for the eyes overall, and things like that. So this is a taste of all the reports that we generate and we utilize for our further applications. This is a sample of the LM80 life test report. And the LM80 test report, 80 test report, is actually how this, like we mentioned that, you know, what is the, this is the luminous flux. So this is what it was to start with. And as we went on in number of hours, so at 6,000 hours, at 25 degrees centigrade, it remained almost the same, right? It went up, in fact, and came down here. At 55 degrees, it came here. At 85 degrees, it came here. So if we went to further, say 105 degrees here, it would come a little lower. So as the temperature increases, what's really happening is that the phosphor is in some way getting less efficient. It's getting diminished in its performance. And so we get these reports. And this is very important to, you know, declare or specify an LED that, okay, this is that good or not so good, or till what temperature this is good, and how much, variation will come. And also, actually, I've not shown here, but similarly in the LM80, this is the lumens maintenance. We also have the CCT maintenance. So because CCT would also change to a lesser degree though, but it will have an effect. So the light, initially a warm white, might tend to get more towards the bluish side, because we must remember that inside there is a blue chip of LED. And if the phosphor develops a pinhole or becomes depleted, then more of the blue will pass through. These are more details, the readings out of a LM80 report. Here we've got the sample size. These are the three different temperatures we talked about. And this is the test current which we have used. This is the duration of the test. And this is the projection. This shows that we've done a test till 4,000 hours, and then we have projected it beyond that by statistical extrapolation. And these are the temperatures and so on. So here, like you can see, the reported L70, which we talked about here at 25 degrees, is greater than 54,000 hours, right? Calculated is, say, 60,000, but we have to keep a safety margin because it's a statistical extrapolation. So we declare it as 54,000 hours. Now here it's a depiction of the history of lighting. So starting from the candle and to the oil gas lamp, the incandescent lamp, the fluorescent lamp, CFL. This is 2006, we talked about when the white LED came on the scene. Now, a bit about the LED construction. This is historically what the LED, you know, initially this is how it looked like. It was in a plastic package like this, and we had the positive and negative identified by the lead lens. The negative side is this is the cathode, and this is the actual LED diode inside it, and this is a transparent cover. And now the modern LED now has started looking like this. There's a package. It's a surface mount device. This is the cathode, the sub mount, the LED chip, the lens, thermal heat sink to take out the heat, you know, because a lot of heat is generated and we want to protect the chip. This is the bonding wire which connects to the chip, to the outside world. Now, LED working briefly, basically the P-type, the N-type, semiconductor materials, and this is what, you know, when the electron actually jumps from a higher state to a lower state, this is when we have the release of light or photons. And the same is picturized over here. And this is when it is, if it is no current flowing, if it is reverse bias, then there is a zone, and the holes, the P and N type, the electron and holes are not really coming into contact and there's no flow. And once you bias it in a forward direction, then the conduction and light emission starts. And this is how I've shown here that, you know, how do we change the colors of the LED? Basically, we use different, you know, materials. So the semiconductor materials are listed here. The forward voltage changes because, you know, the energy jump in the electron would be depending on the specific type of semiconductor material that we're talking about. So you see the voltage is different. Like the green LED would have a voltage from this to this. A red LED would have a lower voltage. And if you look at the blue, it is 2.5 to 3.7. So average is about 3, let's say. And that is the most predominant because this is what we use in very large quantity for white. And these days, like, we have started using ultraviolet. So ultraviolet is also quite similar around 3 region, you know. So we started using it in this COVID times. So this is how different colors of LEDs would be made. And this is the popular package of white LED. Here, you know, the thermal dissipation would take place like this. This is what I've shown. The package size, when we call it 2835, it means 28 is 2.8 mm by 3.5 mm, and this is the height. And you know, basically here, so basically high CRI, etc. CRI is usually kept above 80. Now, this standard we've talked about here is very important. It's a photobiological safety standard. So this is where, you know, we want to make sure that the LED used is safe for the eyes. So we have certain dosage that, okay, this much, it should not be beyond a certain standard dosage which the human being would experience by using the light. Thermal designs which we make are, you know, I'm just given a chart of when we design thermal products, and these are the temperatures, you know, of the different, let's say, components inside the product. And for example, the LED itself, we'd like to keep it at 85 degrees centigrade, not beyond it. So I've just given a benchmark of, you know, how to make a product. This is the chip on board LED, which is actually multiple chips on a single device like this. So here we have the power, here we have the color temperature. It could also be, it's not as if this would not, it would be possible to get this at this temperature. And here's a very interesting chip on board where we have, you know, two kinds of colors of the LED chips deposited on it. And by mixing these two colors, we can produce intelligent lighting, which is becoming more and more popular. We can set the mood by the electronic controls or by our application or by, you know, mobile phone, etc. This is another new LED, which is actually a filament lamp imitation. So this is called a filament LED, and it looks like a filament. It's a straight, but it is a series and parallels of LEDs in a form of this stick or rod. And the beauty here is that it has got 360 degrees of light, just like a normal bulb is. Normal incandescent bulb is the most beautiful light source. So we are trying to come close to it. We tried to come close to it in terms of CRI. Here we are trying to come close to it in terms of the viewing angle. And so this is also becoming good popular for the applications of aesthetics. This we talked about the different forward voltages, about the different colors of LEDs and the different forward voltages. So I'll skip this now. This picture depicts the how the over the period of time, how the cost of LEDs, the cost per lumen of LEDs has been moving down, and light output in a package has been going up. This is a overview of the LED packaging process. It's actually 11 steps. I won't go into all the details, but basically it's like you have this wafer, and then the probing, the testing, and the construction, the die attach, interconnection, and then producing an SMD LED with modern technology. The steps are again listed properly here. And these are the 11 steps in which we manufacture the LED devices themselves. This is a picture which shows that by using those LEDs, when we make our products, electronic LED products, this is the flow chart of the assembly process, and where we start with a bare PCB, and we have SMD devices, and we have reflow soldering here, we have wave soldering, and then we have hand soldering if required, and this is how we complete the product. These are the parts of a LED bulb. Many of you would have opened bulbs, and it's now quite simplified. You have a driver here, you have the LEDs here, and the interconnections and body, and this is the heat sink. This is a schematic. I think we don't have to go into details, but it's quite simplified now. Basically, important point is that it's a current source, and which is important to drive the LEDs. These are different LED fixture types, indoor, outdoor, others, which we have, and I'll move to the next slide to show you some of these. These are the indoor fixtures. Many of you would have seen most of them. Interesting one here is the bay light, and another interesting one is this tea lamp. It's like a lamp come a tube light. This is for the beauty, aesthetic beauty, up down kind of light. This is a tube light, and these are panels. These are outdoor lights, floodlight, street light, and then these are other applications. An interesting one here is the aviation light, which is used on top of buildings, used driven by solar power, and it has certain standards of display. And these are the wall washers. Then the lasers, I've given details here. They could be semiconductor lasers, or they could be the discharge type. And this is the application of, say, laser cutting. That's a security system. These are the simple, small, portable lasers which use as pointers for longer distances. Here is another very important and beautiful application, and it's a part of our daily life. Sometimes I wonder if, these cables were to, God bless, not get disrupted in some way. Of course, there's a lot of redundancies that we have built in now, and we're building more every day, but then the bandwidth is increasing. But this kind of infrastructure would not have been possible without fiber optics. And fiber optics is again a beautiful application of light. And so this is an important one. And this is a map showing that we have six at as on date, we have six over 63,000 miles of submarine cables transmitting our communications across the world. The another latest now application is the OLEDs, and which is becoming very popular. It's actually, instead of the semiconductor devices, we've fabricated over there thin films which are sandwiched between the conductors and can be made even flexible and rollable. And that's another very good application of lighting. And this is the brief structure I've given here. And the processes of emission of light is similar, but the construction is different from the standard LED. These are the different layers inside the OLED: cathode and electron transport layer, and blocking layer, emissive layer, hole transport. Here you have the RGB, right? And hole injection, anode, and substrate. These are the examples of, and this one really looks beautiful, and I'm sure you'll all agree. So And then the light-based computing, and in our research at Chandigarh there, we are doing work on the field of photonics. And this is the latest area of applications of mixed application of photons with electrons someday, and which rely on the quantum behavior. And we are actually exploiting the on the surface of the wire, we are exploiting the light behavior to get the speed of light of communications inside an application like a futuristic computer. So that's an upcoming area. And then we have these UV light applications here. Here is a hospital robot, and we have a railway station. We have this house robot doing ultraviolet cleaning. We have like a mobile phone. We have a UV source for disinfection. This is a bus going through a tunnel and getting disinfected. And this is a data sheet which is similar to the standard visible LED. It's the for the UV data sheet. It's one of the latest LEDs which we have, and the structure is similar. And I just thought I'll show this to you. This is the physical shape of this LED. Then another very good application these days is the plant grow lights, the horticultural lights, and which makes the plants more grow much better and faster, so may make the whole vegetable scene more sustainable. So here we got an experiment here, where which was done on a certain type of plant for 40 days. Here, white LEDs have been used, two white LEDs. This is with three white LEDs. This is three red and one blue, led to this much in 40 days. Here is an LED data sheet sample, which is you can see inside this there are different colors, so it's optimized for application in plant growth. And this is the features of the plant growth light. Like, the important point here is that we talk of, just like we talked of lumens there, we talk of micromoles per second. So this is basically the photosynthetic flux, PPF, what we call. So which is the useful light output for plant growth application. And this is Li-Fi, which is also being developed in recent times, and where actually what we are doing is that unlike the Wi-Fi, the light itself, it's a normal light to us, but it's also carrying the data information, two-way data information on it. So it could have very good applications where we don't want interference of the signal, in applications like aircraft. We say, okay, turn off your devices, but then if you have a Li-Fi kind of situation, then there's no problem. Similarly, in hospitals and certain military applications, this would have a promising usage. And then, of course, needless to mention that in astronomy, nothing could have really happened without light. So it's used to get all gather all the details every day, new discoveries. The frontiers are reaching out further and further every day with better, detection about light, which has eliminated billions of years back. And like I like to say that we are really, when we look at the sky, clear sky, it's really a blueprint of the history. What we are seeing today could be years or millions of years back, which is now falling on our eyes. Those packets of light hitting our, retina and or our gadgets or telescopes and telling us more and more. So it's really the whole history of the universe and life is captured and coming to us all the time through the skies. In summary, light is used for all these devices, all these applications, and so many more every day. And life, we cannot imagine life without light. So let us celebrate light on this International Day of Light 2020. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much for your
My
very
pleasure.
inspirational and very informative talk. Yeah. So, sir, now the session is open for question and answers.
Yes.
Yes. So I shall read the questions from the chat box window and okay. we can take up them quickly.
Okay, sir?
Yeah. So I'm starting from the bottom. So yeah, so Preeti Thakur is asking, does Li-Fi provide one-way link? So it's for download only. Who invented Li-Fi?
Well, I won't be able to tell you who invented it offhand, but yeah, it can do two-way communication, right? It's capable of two-way communication.
Okay. She's also asking, what are the few experimental evidence that suggest that photon has no mass?
That photon has no mass. See, actually, we must remember that, you know, mass and energy are totally interrelated by Einstein's equation, famous equation. So really, you know, we cannot say that if a, I would say if a particle has, if it's a particle, a photon is a particle, it has energy, obviously it has mass. So
yeah,
quantum theory will can go into more details.
Okay. Right.
But energy, to my mind, is just a multiplier and it's mass.
Okay, sir. So next is from Praveen, sir. How to measure CIE colors of OLEDs?
Okay, fine. Yeah. See, Praveen, as far as the CIE is concerned, you know, it's really we start from the base is the black body, as I said. So it's not as if, you know, the nature of the colors, so the nature of the light source would really matter, because it could be a CFL lamp, or it could be a LED, or it could be an OLED, or any other source for that matter. So we could still use the same CIE diagram.
Okay. Yes. So next question is from Preeti. What is the difference between lumens, kelvins, and watts?
Lumens, kelvins, and watts. Okay. See, lumens is actually the light which is emitted. So if there's a bulb, you know, we say that, okay, if it's a 10 watt bulb and it's got an efficacy of 100 lumen per watt, so, you know, it'll be emitting. The lumens, if we measure, it will be 10 into 100, that will be 1,000 lumens, right? So okay. I think that defines the relation between lumen and watts, Preeti. And then the degree K is actually the temperature part of it. Lumens is the intensity of light, and K is actually the color, the shade. So depending on, so if it is like, let's say 6,500, it's like nice white light, and if it's, let's say, 3000, it's like a yellowish light. That is the relation between lumen, K, and watt.
Okay, sir. So next is how to calculate CRI from CIE coordinate.
Okay, so yeah. For CRI, it's really the measurement, and you know, we really have to see the composition of the light. And ideally speaking, basically to visualize it, you know, if we are on the Planckian curve, then it's going to be, the CRI will be the closest to 100. And if it's departing away from it, or it has different frequencies, you know, then different mix of frequencies, you know. So what we really do is that in a spectroradiometer, when we analyze that light, then we take out its components, you know, different components, how much red is there, how much blue, how much green. So we take those ratios and we have a standard chart, and we have a formula for computing this and arriving at a figure of merit, which is the CRI.
Okay. Okay, sir. So next question, like, is there any type of free or light source could active solar panel? Is there any type of fire or light source that could active solar panel? I don't know what. Preeti, if you mute yourself.
Oh, you mean to say, yeah, you can ask yourself, yes?
Yeah, Preeti, you can unmute yourself and just ask, take up this question. Like, you have asked something which is not clear.
Yes, Preeti, please.
In the meanwhile, sir, we can go to the next question.
Okay.
Like, why are parabolic mirrors used in such light and not concave spherical? Why parabolic mirrors are used in searchlight?
In searchlight.
Yeah,
In
and
searchlight.
not concave.
Okay. Not concave. Correct, correct. Okay. So basically, see, in a search, ultimately, we want to have in a searchlight, we want to have a very narrow beam, right?
Okay.
So we want
Yes.
the throw of the light to be very high. So to form that kind of a beam, if you have a simple concave kind of a mirror, I think you have to optimize it, because between the exact shape has to be optimized. The curve will have to be optimized depending on what is the actual beam angle you want. I mean, after all, you don't want it zero also. You want certain practical beam angle. So based on that, you would design a ideal mirror depending on the position of the source, and also there would be optics like a lens, just like you have in the headlight of a car. So you may have a combination and get the optimum results depending on the, again, the exact application.
Okay, sir. So next is how much maximum light intensity of OLED pixel diode can produce?
OLED, how much light?
Pixel
See,
diode.
generally, as of now, the OLED, first of all, is very expensive, and it still doesn't compete with the standard LED for lighting applications. But for applications like displays, for example, we talk of TVs, then because of its overall other merits, the quality of picture is so good. And it's such a thin film that can do the job. So every day it's improving. I mean, coming closer and closer to what we have for standard LEDs. So
Okay, sir.
OLEDs is improving. So it still has to come close to the standard LEDs as far as my information goes. But it's approaching that. And the efficiency, of course, is very high.
Okay, sir. So one last question from the chat box that we can take is, like, please explain the difference between fluorescence and chemiluminescence, asked by Swati.
Fluorescence and
Chemiluminescence.
chemi. Yeah, okay. See, chemi is when you have a chemical, say there's a combination or let's say parameters of a chemical, which would, I mean, in certain forms they could be interrelated, but a fluorescent material is a material which is constantly giving out a certain radiation, right? It's fluorescent means it's when a light is falling on it, it's fluorescent. But a chemi might be in a, let's say, for a limited duration, a combination of chemicals. So it would be, I think, a more generic term, and that's what I can think of at this point of time.
Okay. Well, one more question we can take. What is the significance of white light LEDs, and why don't we have till now?
Why don't we
Yeah.
have
Them till now.
white LED? No, we do have till now. I mean, like we mentioned that they were introduced way back in 2006. So they
Okay.
white LEDs have been with us for the last 14 years now, and they have been improved upon. So all lighting that you see now is done by white LEDs.
Okay, sir. So I think that's all, like, that many questions we can take from the chat box window. If anyone want to directly interact with sir,
Yes.
can unmute yourself and ask, because as we are running short of time, so that is why direct interaction would be better. Otherwise, sir, we have many questions in the chat box window.
Okay,
Yeah.
sure. You can also go to my website and you can send me an email or message, and I'll send more details and talk to you.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
So anyone, yeah.
Hello, sir. It
You have a
was
question?
nice to sir. Sir, I have a question regarding that white LED. I know that white LED is white light produced by a combination of blue and yellow. It's not pure white.
No, actually, it's not. We cannot say it's blue and yellow. As I explained, basically, the inside, the heart of that white LED is actually a blue LED. That is correct. So the
Yeah.
yellow which you are mentioning, yes, in a way you can say that, basically when the phosphor comes into the picture, It absorbs the blue light, and you know the phosphor, and then in turn absorbs that energy and emits different colors. It receives blue colors and it emits like, yes, yeah, you are right, there are yellow phosphors also, they give you a yellowish shade, that's very true. So, and with you, an ideal mixture depending on what you want from, what shade you really want. So you have the phosphor of that particular composition, and then it converts, you know, by its kind of formulation that it is. It converts that blue. So you have the blue as it is, plus you have the, you know, secondary frequencies coming out from the phosphor, and the combination gives you the exact shade which you want. Yes. So in a way, you, what you explained is correct. It is a combination. Yes, it's a combination. Correct.
So it's a, it has a broad bandwidth.
Yes, you know, white. Yes, white color has, actually it's supposed to have all the frequencies, isn't it? We know that, all the colors. So that is what white is. So we try to approach that white by, you know, combining these different dosages of red, blue, and green, and the intermediate colors to get it as flat as possible.
But a single LED is not polishable, like in case of red or green.
Single LEDs are there of different colors, red, green, and blue. And also, if they have phosphor, and then they become white. So there are white LEDs, there are colored LEDs. So all LEDs are available.
Okay. Hello, sir.
And all shades of white are also available. I hope it makes it clear.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Hello, sir.
So, Dr. Santosh can ask a question. Yes. Yeah, we can take more questions after that.
Okay. Yes. Good afternoon, sir. My question is that as the LED watt is increasing, just like 5 watt, 10 watt, 23 watt, and further, the lumen is increasing. But we are that how much lumen intensity can our eye can bear?
Yes, you know, that depends on the application. Now, see, if you have a very high power LED, and even let's say I mentioned about the photobiological standard. So even if you have an LED which qualifies to that standard, but it's your application, let's say, is very high intensity. Suppose it's a floodlight. Now, you cannot, you know, go near a floodlight and look straight into that. So you have to have certain, you know, for depending on the application, like, okay, if it's a tube light, then, you know, the tube light is going to be on the roof. So,
sir, actually, for home application, I'm asking, in our daily life, we are using tube light. So we are feeling comfortable from that light. But as the LED we are using, so if I use 5 watt LED, the light is very dim. If I use 23 watt LED, the light is too bright. How much of the lumen of light can affect our eye?
Yeah, that's a good question. See, therefore, you know, you, whenever you are designing the lighting of any room or house or anything like that, so you have to choose the fixtures of a certain wattage. Okay, if it is, let's say typically a tube light is 20 watts generally.
Tube light is 40 watt.
If it's 40 watt, you know, 40 watt, maybe two tubes, a twin of tubes, or, you know, you can usually, you won't have, rarely we use 40 watt single tube as such. We will use two tubes, you know, we want to the light to be a little dispersed. But yes, whenever the wattage is going high than the normal standard, then you have to ensure that you're not looking straight into it. It could be indirect, you know, for example. You have concealed lighting, you know, you have a fixture such that it diffuses the lighting, because sharp light should not come straight to your eye, and particularly actually, LED light should not come
Actually, I feel this problem because of my child. Children are getting too much irritated because of if I use the heavy watt LEDs.
Yes, you are absolutely right. There have been certain studies even in office and homes and on in human beings. And this is very important. And that's why, you know, we have that photobiological standard I talked about. And we should not have products which are over-designed in terms of the brightness, in terms of the power. That's not advisable, you know, because it may not be good for the health, particularly of children. Because children may not know, okay, as an adult, you know, you look away from a light more instinctively. A child may just stare, and before he or she reacts, you know, so it can have a negative effect. So it's always better to have smooth, soft, indirect light if possible, you know, plan the architecture in such a way and don't have very you know, high wattage or high lumen fixtures, high brightness fixtures.
So is there any rating available for not harmful to eye?
Yes, usually when we have these standards, you know, that's why I said we qualify the LEDs also, and even the products can be tested for their effect on the eyes. And if they are very bright, if for a certain application, if they're very bright, then they should not be qualified. We have standards for that.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Hello.
Sir, as we are running short of time, so I think, sir, you can just write your email address in the chat box window so people can directly interact with you
through email. I'll do that.
Yeah. So thank you so much, sir, for your talk.
Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity. It was a pleasure.
So it was our pleasure to have you as a speaker.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, sir. So now you can stop sharing your screen.
Okay, yes.
And next, we'll... Yeah, Rishabh, are you there?
Yes, Anupma.
Rishabh, you can give the presenter rights to Rajiv, sir, by the time. Yeah. And now it's again my pleasure to welcome our next speaker and to briefly introduce him. So our next speaker is Dr. Rajiv Jindal. He has done his PhD in physics from IIT Delhi in 1998. He did his MSc from IIT Roorkee and PhD from Rohilkhand University. He has presented and published more than 30 papers at various conferences and journals and filed 20 patents. He is currently working as VP Business Development at CNS Electric Limited. Before joining CNS, he has worked various stints as Intel Electronics, IIT Kanpur, Visible India, Fairchild Optical Instruments, Mississippi State University, USA, and University of Illinois at France. His research and current areas of interest are energy efficient devices, including solid state lighting, example LEDs, WLEDs, OLEDs, and electric vehicles. So, with this brief intro, I welcome you, sir, for your talk. Yes, sir.
Thank you so much, Anupma. And I would like to thank IEEE ACSIR CSIR student branch for inviting me for this talk. Thank you. It's always a pleasure to talk to the students. So, it's always good to be here. I just switch off my video just for the bandwidth issue and just move to a presentation.
Yes, sir.
So, Arun, you have made my job easier and tough also a bit, but I'll just take from where Arun left and take you through something which is beyond just lighting. See, what Arun took you through is a beautiful application of what our light can do for us, how light and how we cannot do without light in our life, and which is a huge fact. Like, imagine a day without being illuminated. Like, imagine walking into a village with no lights around us. So just imagining our life without light is impossible. What I'm going to take you through is something what is happening in research area these days, and where basically what all light can do, a tiny light source, a LED light can do for us, this is just beyond illumination. It is really becoming a powerful source, and it is just going beyond illumination. And I'll take you some of the works that I'm involved in currently right now. So, as many of you might know, lighting has been a talked about subject for years and years and years. And if you look at it, it was 1,000 years back that fire was developed as, and it was used as light source for almost 5,000 years. And it took somebody called Edison in 1890 to first give us an artificial source of light in form of an incandescent bulb. And it took another 60 years for us a fluorescent light to come out, and then another 50, 60 years for LEDs to come out as a light. So from a research perspective, and if you compare this to a research of something what a computer does these days, this is a very slow improvement area. But really, after the advent of LED, things are really changing very fast. And I will take you to some of the works that have been done on that right now. So I'll just recap slightly what all illumination is all about. So LED technology, as Arun also mentioned, it's a PN junction. And basically, you pass current through a PN junction, and the change of when you play with that PN junction, you can the photons can go from the higher state of energy to a lower state of energy, and the light is emitted in that transition. Now, advantage of this thing is, since it's a semiconductor material, so it's two beautiful advantage from a physics perspective. That you can actually generate any wavelength of light just by that band gap engineering. By changing the band gap between the conduction band and the valence band, you can almost develop any wavelength that you want to develop. So it's almost a monochromatic wavelength that you can develop by that playing with that band gap engineering. I'll come to that application more and more, how that is being used. It's an electronic component, so it's as controllable as any other electronic component, either physically or remotely. And that gives us a huge power in hand of a user or a researcher on how to use this LED source or point as a way to develop various applications. So, as Arun mentioned, as you know, that a white light is basically a combination of three basic colors, like red, blue, and green. And so, if you want to produce a white light, what we can do basically is to have three LEDs. Red, green, and have them mixed in a certain ratio, develop a white light. But the problem with that kind of an application, it looks very simple, is that the thermal footprints of each of these colors is very different. So even if you develop a white light using the three basic colors of red, blue, and green, this will not be a very stable white light, and the white color will drift very soon, within a couple of hours, and your light color will start changing pretty quickly. So it was actually the invention of blue LED by a scientist called Nakamura-san, who used to work for Nishia, that he developed a beautiful blue LED, and which, when used in combination of a yellow phosphor, and this phosphor could be yellow, this could be orangish yellow, or this could be reddish yellow, depending upon the net that you want the light to produce, that we could a beautiful white light LED. And so it was 2005-2006 that this invention really started. And now sitting in 2020, kind of becoming the way of life for all the light sources. So basically, these days, lighting inevitably means LEDs only. So LED technology is like, once you have a light source in your hand, How do you make a product of it? It's pretty simple, that you have LED, you mount them on MCB. You basically mount hundreds of LED on an MCB, because all these are surface mountable chips. Through a simple chip shooter technology, you can develop. They're all DC-based devices. So the power which is coming from wall is an AC. So you need to have... I'm hearing some noise in the background.
Hello? I request everyone to kindly mute yourself. All the participants, please. Yes, sir, you can.
Yeah. So we basically need a what is called an AC-DC converter, or what in typical layman terms is called a driver, to convert the wall coming current into a DC, which in turn drive the series of LEDs to give us the light. And we can control that heat of that light, which is generated through what is called a heat sink. And if you want a specific distribution of a light, we can use on top of these LEDs what is a simple lens, or so we can just change the beam angle of the light which is coming out. A typical LED actually gives us a beam angle of 120 degrees, so it's a directional source. It gives the 120 degree beam angle, and you can change this beam angle using the series of optics. So this is a basic construction of any light that we have. So basically a heat sink in which LEDs are mounted, and power is coming in there, and we have a simple AC-DC converter which is sitting inside. So using these things, you can make any form factor that you want. So you see all these outdoor luminaires, which could be in form of street lights or flood lights or bay lights or decorative outdoor lights, or it could be simple 2x2s or downlighters or tube lights or bulbs, whatever you are using inside houses, or some industrial uses like and maybe bay lights and again different kind of tube structures or flood lights. All this is basically using the same principle that you have a light source which is put in series and parallel and driven by a AC-DC converter, using a heat sink which let the heat go away, and using a lens which helps us to distribute the light in the right way wherever you want to do that. Now, but that was just to recap whatever light can do for us or whatever LED technologies are about. What is actually happening these days in research is that, remember what I told you is, it's a simple p-n junction, but it's a p-n junction, so it means we have a band gap which is available with us. So with that band gap, what you can basically do is do a beautiful band gap engineering. You can change the wavelength of the light that is being produced by. So by changing the wavelength of light, you can produce many other applications which are covered. And since I'll just repeat myself from the initial slides, since it's an electronic component, so effectively each LED can be used as a remotely or like an electronic source just at the point of the use also. So a few of the applications which I will cover, which are huge areas of research worldwide, is I'll talk something what is called about a human-centric lighting, something which is of very permanent, very effective use these days is lighting used for disinfection purpose. I will go slightly deeper into that. I'll go deeper into what Li-Fi is and what are the uses and how does the technology actually work. Then I will go into OLEDs, that what is it all about. So what is the human-centric lighting is? See, we all are humans. So we rise with the sun and we go down with the sun, and we sleep with, we sleep when the sun goes down. I'm not talking about these days youngsters, like, okay, it's these days get up to 3 in the night. I'm talking about in general human being nature is that we rise with the sun and we go down to bed with the sun. So our body also has inbuilt sensors which reacts to the light which is around us. And by the color of the light which is around us, our body knows that what time of the day it is and how it is supposed to be. Like, for example, very early in the morning, the sun is almost reddish white. Huge, it's a very bright red, or either very early in the morning or very late in the evening. And while the sun is in the around the noon time, the sun is almost whitish blue. Right. So the color of the sun is changing as the day goes by. This is just a simple scattering phenomena. We have all of us see this in our high schools and 12th, right? So since this is happening, while the lights that we are using currently in all our applications, we have a single color light. So we either have a bluish white light or a reddish white light or a yellowish white light installed in our home, and that kind of stays with us throughout the day. So it means that at certain point of the time of the day, we are living in an atmosphere which is against our biological phenomena, right? Because our biology is demanding or expecting some different colors to be around us. Because if we get up in the morning and if we are put through a very bright white light, we sometimes feel very overwhelmed by that color because it's too bright for our sensors to react to that. So what can be, so just to put a different perspective, this is the kind of color that a human being needs at different kind of a day. So a huge research is being done on this area. Can we make light to go and change its color as the human needs it as per their need during the day? Right? So can my light be orangish white in the morning? It could be bluish white in the day, and it could be again orangish white around the late evening hours. And Can it just change its color as a day changes, and a human body can actually feel that it is living in the atmosphere which is supposed to live. Right? So there's a typical office atmosphere. Like, so suppose in an office early in the morning it's kind of a discolor of light, and while in the mid of the day around 2 o'clock it could be bluish white, and while around the evening, it's again yellowish white light which is being done. So current LED technology has made it possible to do this. As I showed you in the beginning, see, a white light is a combination of blue light and then the phosphorus put on top of it. So what we can do is that either we could have, what we can do is basically we could have five channels of lights. So it could be RGB, red, blue, green, basic LEDs, and a light which is a kind of a cool white light or a bluish white light, and a light which is warm white light. And we put a string of these together, and we can control the various intensity of those lights and the output of these lights, and auto-tune them for the day. We can have a light which changes its property as per the human need throughout the day. So we can actually replicate the same behavior just by combination of these five lights. And just by three lights, if I just put white, and white, three different kind of white lights, and I doesn't put red, blue, green on top of it, I can partially do it. Maybe some colors are not possible, like 2200K, or maybe I'm looking for some very reddish white kind of a light. That may not be possible, but most of it is possible through three channels. But through five channels, LED channels, all the colors are almost possible, whatever I need for a human body to have. And since it's an electronic device, what I can also develop is an IoT-based platform that I could develop a mesh sitting outside somewhere else, and I can control the light configuration in a particular room or in a particular atmosphere by just reprogramming it, or even controlling it on the spot at the same time, just by a simple Wi-Fi or a mesh technology. I can simply control it from a remote location also. And LED technology allows me to do that because it's a semiconductor device. It's like just simply controllable through if I just interfere with this with the driver. If I just have a control of driver through a remote location, I can change its output, and I can change it, the behavior of it. So this is one beautiful application. It's a huge area of research which is coming up in Europe. Also, it's a big area of work which is going on, and some of the world top leading companies are working on what is called human-centric lighting. The next application, which is a big area of research these days, is microbiological disinfection using LED lights. So, think of it, light is everywhere. We all have lights all in our rooms, you walk in a hospital, you have lights in the corridors, you have all patients' rooms have lights, everywhere there is a light. Now, what happens if I can just convert that light source into a disinfection source? I could have a disinfection possibility throughout the day, at each places every time, theoretically, yes, right? So what we can do is that we have two technologies which is coming up: UVC technology, which is a traditional solution, and I'll just go deeper into that, what does UVC technology is all about. And then the new technology which is coming up is HINS 4.5 nanometer technology, which is a third generation solution, which is a very, very recent work in the UK. So coming to UVC application, as you all know, that 400 to 700 nanometers is a visible range, and if you go below in terms of wavelength or higher in terms of frequency, first band which comes is UVA, then UVB and UVC. It is actually UVC which has the highest any kind of germs that is around. So we can actually there have been applications as we use the many other applications where these UVC lamps has been used to kill bacteria. So what it basically does is breaks that chain of the protein or the nucleic acid, which is, and it basically it absorbs the energy, and by absorbing the energy, it goes into a stage where it kind of breaks that molecular chain, and so your disinfection bacteria are killed by that. So this is the range in which it basically works, is 250 to 270 nanometers, but it most effective since is the peak of the absorption in between 260 to 275 nanometers. So this is where it is most effective. And most of the viruses like E. coli or Staphylococcus or any other virus is known to be having its peak absorption wavelength at this wavelength range. So if I can develop a UV LED with this kind of a wavelength range, I can see bacteria by putting light off that particular wavelength. So I can put this in any kind of a conventional light form. Like suppose if I need it for tube lights, I can simply load it this way. Or if I need it for larger area, I can put in a high bay or floodlight or anything which I need to do that. Problem is that UVC light has several negative and risks. See, basically it is cancerous. Any UV light, continuous exposure of UV light can be potentially cancerous, and it can have huge negative impact on any human being which is exposed to that kind of light on a continuous basis. So it also you can see that phenomena very well, that if you put up a plastic sheet outside for a long time, since sun not only emits the visible wavelength but it also emits a lot of UV, plastic, what it does is that it starts absorbing that UV light and slowly starts degrading. And same kind of phenomena also happens on us humans also, that continuous exposure to UVC can actually lead to a very, very strong impact on our body, and it could be very negative for us. So so how basically it is being used these days is that you need to have a automatic control system. You need to have what is called a PIR sensor, that you put the light on, but this light should be on when no human is around it. Right? As soon as it sees any human coming within the region of the its light, the light should go off so that human are not exposed to this kind of light. It's only the room, which is when the humans are not there, is disinfected, and then humans can walk into that room, a disinfected room, any time of the day that they want to walk in. So this is the way that this light is being used or can be used, and there are a lot of applications in which this light is being used with this phenomena. So to take care of this particular limitation, what is being developed these days is by a couple of scientists in the UK is a technology at 405 nanometer technology. So if you remember, I just go slightly back. So this is around this kind of wavelength. So it's kind of at a cusp of visible and the UVA range that some work is being done. And if you look at this phenomena, so though the absorption of the direct bacteria is not that much, I'll show how this light actually works. So again, this is where this light has fallen. It has a major advantage over UVC, that it doesn't require to be switched off. This system can continuously disinfect the air, and surfaces can be exposed to it on a continuous basis. What it basically does is that it kills the microbes which are available in air, and that particular light kind of kills those microbes. It's kind of killing the catalyst of that bacteria generation. By killing that bacteria generation, it has been shown to work on bacteria, yeast, fungi, various kind of viruses, that a 405 continuous illumination on a continuous basis can slowly kill that catalyst. And by slowly killing that catalyst, what you can have is basically a surface which is continuously exposed could be very, very clean and avoid of all kind of bacteria and fungus and all those kind of non-wanted generations. So as I said, that this light output is very, very safe for human being. It can be used as an indoor lighting phenomena day in and day out, and even currently the work is being governed that it is in the approval process that this light could be approved for continuous use in the hospitals. So hospitals could be disinfected throughout the day. And as I mentioned, UVC light can have this kind of effect on a plastic surface. But a 405 light has almost no impact. See, this is compared to a non-exposed area versus a 405 exposed area versus a fluorescent, which is also a non-UV light. So that kind of a so no polymer damage. So it's kind of very safe light which is being developed these days. And this paper as late as 2016, I've seen a couple of more papers from the same people. So what you can have a simple a 2x2 fixture or a 1x1 fixture or whatever fixture can do. You can put this kind of a 405 light along with your normal white light. And what you can do is that when the room is used, you can switch off this disinfection light if you want to, and you could have simple normal light coming in. But at other point of time, when you want a disinfection mode to be on, you can switch on the disinfection mode along with the normal white light. So both the lights can work in parallel, and your room could be disinfected while you're walking out there also. So like in a hospital, there's a normal light and you could have a disinfection light. And so there have been experiments done by the same group earlier that it could reduce bacteria as much as by 80% to 90%, depending upon what's the distance of UV LED to that particular surface and for how long it has been exposed. But it has been found to be very, very effective use of killing the bacteria, I think. And again, it could be controlled in like an IoT mesh or through a Wi-Fi that you could control sitting in a, like suppose it is a hospital. Yeah. In a hospital, you could have a control room, which is just controlling depending upon the need of the hour or depending upon the patient movement in the hospital. It could be controlled remotely, it could be pre-programmed, it could be on the spot program, it could be all IoT connected and Wi-Fi enabled to have this beautiful use of this light to disinfect. And in current situation, it could be a huge game changer when this kind of lights can not only be put in hospitals, but it could be put in offices, in classrooms, in other application wherever we expect many people to be around, and it could help us to disinfect ourselves. Like, what is the need of our systems? So I think I've covered most of these applications. Like it could kill wide range of microscopes. Almost no operational requirements are there. It doesn't have any impact on plastics, and it can just simply work 24/7. So this is an area of research. If any one of you are looking for any research topic, this is a good area of research topic. Second area which next area which I'll be talking about is what is called Li-Fi. It's basically light fidelity. So Arun touched upon this point very briefly, that basically a Li-Fi is, in a very layman term, is a Wi-Fi using light instead of radio waves. So it's put very simply. What does it mean? See, if you look at it that way, you're talking about a simple change of your platter, because your radio frequency to light frequency, the change is almost a megahertz. So you have 10 to power 6 more bandwidth available for you to transmit your data. So what it means is that you could have potentially an enormous amount of data which you can put on in these channels just by a simple modulation. So how does it basically works is that you have a server or an internet and you could have a streaming content, and what you do is that this content you override onto a driver. So you remember I told you this AC to DC converters where you have these drivers, driver technology. So you can simply put your streaming on top of the driver. So whatever current it is pushing into LED, it could have a high frequency wave sitting on top of it, which modulates the light output which is going around. Right? So just by modulation, simple modulation technique, you can transmit the data from an internet or server to a photo detector, and that photo detector works as a receiver, and then it gives to another computer. So a simple kind of a Wi-Fi technology. Instead of using radio waves, I'm using light waves here. But as I already mentioned, since light waves means basically 10 to power 14 hertz kind of a frequency bandwidth available to us, so even a 0.001% of that bandwidth would mean terabits of data, which can potentially be transmitted. And that's the application which also fiber optics used to have this kind of huge data transmissions that are available to this. So you could have this in the form of multiple things also. You could have a data stream coming in, you could have Li-Fi router, you could modulate a bulb which would simply give it to the Wi-Fi dongle or a built-in receiver. You could have another stream which is going to a separate computer. So it all can be modulated, it all can be developed, it all can be worked out like a Wi-Fi deployment system works. It all can be worked out. And so how it basically works is that there are certain advantages and limitations of this technology right now. As I said, that the huge advantage is that it's a super fast data rate transmission. It's riding on the line. The problem is that it will only work in the line of sight. So you need to be under a light for your data to actually come. See, you need to be in the path of that light ray for your data to be coming to you. So that's kind of a disadvantage. But if you look at the other side, it could be a huge security point also, right? If you don't want your data to be tracked or tapped into by somebody else, you could simply have a code onto the light and you could not have others access to that particular light stream physically itself. See, nobody can tap into your data if you don't allow them a physical proximity anyway, right? So it's a huge security thing, and even a lot of military applications are being developed on this right now. The challenge is, as I already mentioned, it only works in a line of sight. So if any physical disruption comes, it can block the flow of the data. So that is a technology which researchers are working on these days, on how to overcome these kind of phenomena right now. And a potentially a kind of a challenge, but which can be much easier come over is that actually a light needs to be switched on when you need data and you don't want light to be there. So that's another thing. Somebody asked a question that where it was developed. It was developed in initial years around 2011 by some scientist in some group in UK. I don't remember the name exactly. I think it was somebody in Haas or somebody. It was 2011 in UK that this work actually started. Then the next thing which is very close to my heart and is another area of research which is being developed these days is what is called OLED light. Now, what does OLED lighting mean about? So, putting it very simply, LED is basically an inorganic material source. So, basically, material is either amorphous based or gallium based or whatever it is based on. But these are these are inorganic materials which are grown by high cost machines, which are kind of MOCVD technology. That their multiple layer structures are grown. OLED, on the other hand, uses what is called organic material. Now, many of you might be familiar with organic materials, many of you might not be familiar with organic materials. Organic materials are basically materials which are available around us in some or other form, and we just need to convert that into a usable form for the particular device that we want to use. So, potentially, these materials can be extremely cheap and be available in abundance. So this is what OLED is different from a pure, if I talk about the material science perspective. From a usability perspective, how I usually tell my colleagues or whoever in our community, how we talk about is that you can compare a LED versus a OLED to a sun versus a sky. Right. So LED is kind of a sun. It's a very bright point source, which you kind of put in the right form factor to get the right use, whatever you are looking for. But OLED is a more diffused form of a light. You see this kind of a light surface, or this kind of a light surface, or this kind of a light surface. It's kind of a diffuse kind of light surface. So imagine a room in which you don't have a tube light to give you light, but actually it is a whole roof which is giving you light. So OLED is a technology like that, or it's a simpler wall which is giving you light, or it's a table on which you're working is giving off you light. How it basically works is that you have a glass cover, and you basically have, it's a sandwich of glass or plastic on both the sides, and then you have the anode and cathode structure, and then you deposit the right organic compound, either evaporation or by printing method, to have this RGB color coming in. And now, another advantage of OLED is that it gives a very pure form of light. Like in terms of the contrast, in terms of display, though display is not the topic of the discussion today, in terms of the display, this is probably the best display that is going to come in the near future. And how you usually have a display being talked about, a good display or a bad display, is the contrast depth. So OLED can potentially have a contrast depth of 1 to 5 lux. What it basically means is black will be true black. So black to white ratio could be 5 lux to 1 in terms of the intensity. While a usual light source has it about 10,000 to 1, which is a good enough display for our eyes, OLED can have it potentially 5 lux to 1. So the huge, huge, huge thing which is coming up in displays and lighting also, this is being developed a source which could have beautiful uses. Like it could be very, very thin. It could be as thin as 1.4 millimeter to 2.1 millimeter. It is another huge advantage of it is that form factors. See, OLED, since it is an organic material which is being developed and it is a low temperature process on which it can work, so what it can basically do is that you could deposit this and use it in different kind of form factors, even bendable. You have seen bendable mobiles coming in. You have this kind of bendable lights being developed in place. Philips has done some beautiful, Philips, Suntable, some other companies have done some beautiful work on this line. In automotive, it is coming at a beautiful application these days. Like I know BMW and some other top-end cars are coming with a dashboard, which is OLED-based dashboards. So you could have different kind of form factors where the whole curvature of the front dashboard can lit up. If you wanted to light up and when just want to read or look into your car, you simply tap onto that and the whole dashboard will kind of glow. So that kind of form factor is possible. It's just very lightweight, so it goes into aviation beautifully. It goes into some kind of applications like in hospitals in some areas where you want light to be very, very smooth for patients. It gives a beautiful smooth light. So it could be used for that kind of an application these days. So I'll just summarize my talk this way, that lighting technology has actually been revolutionized by advent of LED. Not only it has a huge power saving thing, like for example, a 60 watt bulb can be replaced by a 9 watt LED bulb, or a 250 watt normal street light can be replaced by a 120 watt normal LED street light. Also, since it's a very bright point source, it is giving to many new applications. Like, believe me, next generation of automotive lighting will be all LED or OLED based. Like, many companies are coming with tail lights of LED based, which you already might have seen. But what you would see more and more coming is that more and more companies coming with their headlights, which are LED based lights. So that will be a very application which will need a very sharp beam of light going to a huge distance and using LEDs. But as I explained to you in some of the research work which is going on right now, since it's a semiconductor material, it is giving rise to many, many new applications like data transmission. So again, as I mentioned, for disinfection, light is everywhere. So using a light as your data transmission route itself is basically means that you could have a data availability at anywhere you have a light, right? It can give you just the right light or the mood lighting, depending upon the change of color. Like I talked about human-centered lighting and many other applications which can come with this. And of course, disinfection is another big application which light can do. And since it's a dummy source which is just put in your room, so you don't need to have a new disinfectant which needs to be put in there. You could simply use your existing light source itself as a disinfectant, which can be very, very effective. And so many new other applications are coming. Like I've not touched upon horticulture here. I've not touched upon a few other areas which are just coming up. I thought that in the interest of time, I'll restrict myself to 4 applications right now. So in all, being a student of light since 1994, where I started my PhD, so from that time onwards, I've been a huge proponent of lighting as such. I did my PhD in 5 hours. So this light is just going beyond lighting these days. And I'm very excited about it personally. I'm involved in some of these research myself. My company is involved into it. And this looks very exciting for us right now. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir, for a very wonderful session. And now the session is open for question answers. Yeah. So, sir, we have.
Yeah. I'll just switch on my camera. I'm not super comfortable.
Yes, sir.